Enjoy a really powerful, compelling story. And I'm just so honored to be on this stage today and so very honored to be able to be a part of this really great staged reading that we have of Jitney by Mr. August Wilson. Right? Yes. The stage reading came about. I want to give you guys just a little bit of background. I had an idea that I shared with my Associate Dean of Liberal Arts that I wanted to do some sort of theater production that would honor an African-American author, playwright, poet. And it started initially with our kind of Voices from the Village program, which is what spawned this stage reading today. We had gone to Dr. Fred Perry, who is very indispensable in helping to bring this about, and we just started talking and having a conversation with him, and he talked about how August Wilson came to our own metropolitan campus here at Cuyahoga Community College. In the mid to early 90s, he was here, and he watched the production of the play Fences. And it was amazing to hear this story about how August Wilson had come to the Metropolitan Campus at Tri-C. And that really inspired me to say, well, why don't we go ahead and do a production of his, a play of his, to honor that time that he did come to Tri-C. I was a student at Carnegie Mellon, a graduate student at Carnegie Mellon, some 10 plus years ago. And I had an opportunity to go to the Hill District and interview residents from the Hill District. And it was an amazing time talking to the individuals who lived in the Hill, which is where August Wilson hails from. And to hear the residents talk about the Hill, the rich history of the jazz and culture of the Hill, and they described, some of the residents described it as the Harlem of its day. Right? The jazz, the rich culture that was cultivated through the Hill District. But there was one particular story that took resonance with me, and that was when I talked with a resident who talked about how the native son of August Wilson was their pride and joy. That was so meaningful to me, and I never forgot that, and I held on to that. So I thought, how apropos for us to be able to have this stage reading today. And I want to thank everybody for being here. I want to say thank you tremendously to the director, Jimmie Woody. Where are you, Jimmie? Somewhere.
Right here.
There you are. So thank you, cast. Thank you. And again, thank you guys for coming and supporting this endeavor. And enjoy the show. Thank you. And just the power, by the way. I just realized I didn't say my name.
The time is early fall 1977. The setting is a gypsy cab station in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. The paint is peeling off the walls and the floor is covered with linoleum and is worn through in several areas. In the middle of the wall, stage left, sits an old-fashioned potbelly stove that dominates the room. Upstage of it is a blackboard on it which is written the rates of different parts of the city, the dailies, marginally illegal policy numbers. Next to the chalkboard is a posted sign with Decker's rules. Number one, no overcharging. Number two, keep the car clean. Number three, no drinking. Number four, be courteous. And five, replace and clean tools. Downstage on the wall is a payphone. Along the upstage wall is a sofa with several chairs of various styles and ages scattered about to complete the setting. Act 1, Scene 1. The lights come up on Jitney Station. It is mid-morning. The radio is playing. Youngblood and Turnbull sit facing each other on folding chairs in front of the sofa. They're playing checkers with the checkerboard on their knees in front of them, fielding paces, looking out the window. Youngblood moves the checker piece. Turnbull jumps and takes it.
No, man. You can't do that. How you gonna take my man? I'm gonna jump him, fool.
How you gonna jump him with a man sitting there? I got a man sitting there. Is you blind?
Well, put him where he belong in. I ain't seen him sitting there. I thought he was on the other square.
Don't you know? I was checking Chapel Nah.
Well, ain't nobody stirring you. Check that.
Oh, I told you what you're playing with now. Can't nobody beat me. I'm like Muhammad Ali, boy. I'm the greatest.
Young blood, let me have $4. I gotta go.
Come on and move, checker champ. What's the matter now, huh?
I ain't got a feeling. If I had it, you know I'd give it to you.
Come on and play, checker champ.
Turnbull, let me have $4.
Will you come on and move, man?
Let me have $4.
Fielding, you know better than ask me for anything. King me. King me. Come on, checker champ. Let me beat you again.
Brrr, you cheat on me, man.
Brrr. Car service? East Liberty? Where about in East Liberty? That'll be a $4. Lady, I don't care what nobody else charges. That's a $4 trip. All right? Green car? What's the address again? I'll be right there. Doug, let me have $4.
What?
I got to make a run to East Liberty. Give me $4. I'll give it back to you.
Hell, nigga, I ain't no bank.
I'll give me the $4. I gotta get some gas.
If you don't go out and drink up your money, you'll have $4. You won't have to ask nobody.
Ain't nobody ask you what I do with my money. Let me have the
$4. All right, all right. Hit, hit, hit. Now let that be the last thing you ask me for. No one has asked me for nothing else. So one time in your life you ask me for something, and you bring that $4 back here, too.
Fielding ain't gonna do nothing but drink up that money. He's going right out there to the States, though.
Car service. John Eagle? Wait a minute, you gotta get some.
Hey, here, here, I'll take it. Yeah. Where's John Eagle? All right, I'll be right there. Brown car. You already checked out and ready to go? Because I won't be waiting. Okay.
What you looking at me for?
I said nothing to you.
I ain't gonna mess with my car hauling people groceries around.
What you telling me for? I don't care about your business. Becca's the one you ought to be telling where you is and ain't gonna go.
How's everybody here?
Hey, Sheila.
I see your boy down the street got a brand new car.
Who? Who got a brand new car?
Old Pope. He owned a restaurant down on Central.
What'd he get?
He got him a brand new shiny Buick Riviera. How much you hit for, Sheila?
If you know me, Dub, I don't be putting nobody's business in the street. First thing you know, somebody done got killed talking about Sheila said. I ain't gonna have it on my conscience. I don't know nothing.
Well, I know he hit big. He been playing that 261 every day for a year.
I don't know nothing about it. But I do know he's closing up his restaurant. Sydney's tearing it down.
Yeah, they're gonna tear it down before it falls down.
I didn't know you and the Pope was tight.
We ain't tight. I don't know why Dub wanted to tie me up with him.
Oh, now I remember when you all used to be tight.
Well, it must be when he had that little yellow guy working for him. That's the only time you've ever seen me now, man.
Whatever happened to that gal?
Yeah, she married to one of them boys that drove the bus. That's what I hear.
No, she wasn't the one, huh?
Nah, she wasn't the one. Thought she was. Then I believe Rosie done put a curse on me. She don't want me to have no other woman. But then, she didn't want me. Nah. I told her, baby, just tell me what kind of biscuits you want to make. I'm like the mill, man. I can grind it up any way you want. She knew I was telling the truth, too. She couldn't say nothing about it. She said, you a poor man. What I need but a poor man. I told her, say if I make 100, I'll give you 99. She didn't trust me on that. But I went down to the craft game and hit 6 quick licks, left with $163. Went on back up there. She let me in. I laid $100 down on the table and told her, now, if I can just get one of them back, I'll be satisfied. She reached down and handed me a dollar, and I went on in the room and went to bed. Got up, she had breakfast on the table. Wasn't soon long that $99 ran out. Next thing I knew, she had barred the door. I went on and left, but I never could get it off my mind. I said I was gonna find me another woman. But every time I get hold of one, time I lay down with them, I see her face. I told myself the first time I lay down with a woman and don't see her face, then that be the woman I'm gonna marry. That be my little test. Now with that old yellow guy who used to work at Pope's, I seen Rosie's face, but it was blurry, like a cloud or something come over. I say, I gotta try this again. Maybe next time I won't see nothing. She told me she didn't want to see me no more. She told me, come back same time tomorrow, and if she changed her mind, she'd leave the key in the mailbox. I went up there, there was one man in the house and two others sitting on the doorstep. I don't know who had the key.
Car service. Yeah. Sheila.
Sheila here.
Hey, I'm going next door to Cliff.
671 straight, 469 by Spadala. I got it. I'll see you down there later on. You ain't seen Becca, have you?
He was in here earlier this morning. I think he had to make a run and take care of some business.
You know, his boy getting out the penitentiary next month.
No kidding.
After all them years.
Yeah, time go around and come around.
Never stop.
Car service. Be right there. Blue car. And shit, give me a dollar on that 674. I'll give it to you when I get back.
Hey, Billmore.
Ain't no cars in here?
Doug just left. He'll be back in a minute.
Man, I gotta get home. I've been out all night. I have to run. My little lady is gonna be mad at me.
Been out all night, huh?
Mm-hmm. I went down there to that purple man's club.
They had getting fresh down there.
I ain't never seen so many people. Kinda hard to get in. You still have to have a job to get in there.
Oh, well, they glad they changed that rule. Wasn't nobody be down there.
I'll be down there. Shit, I cut me a job.
I know. You work down the hotel. You've been there for a while.
6 years. Been down there 6 years. Started May 16, 1971. Been down there 6 years and I ain't never missed a day. And I ain't never been late. I'm supposed to get a raise. Ooh, my old lady told me if I get a raise, well, she's going to
share young blood.
Come on, man. I gotta get home, man. I've been on all night.
Where you live at?
Bruh, you know where I live at. Everybody knows where I live at. I live out there above the old Frankstown bar.
That's a $4 trip.
Mm-hmm. Nope. Watch this. Let me show you something. Look.
He starts to build a pyramid out of dollar bills and then he blows them over.
Nah. Well, my daddy told me I've been out blowing my money. You could tell it's the truth. Hey, she did not see you do it before.
Come on, Phil.
I thought you were home.
Really?
Yep. Who? Nah, Mr. Becker ain't here. Who? Let me see if I got this. Mr. Pease, Pittsburgh Renewal Council. Yeah, I'll tell him.
Boy, I don't know what this world is coming to. You know McNeil, don't you?
Who?
McNeil. McNeil would live on Webster. Old lady McNeil. Got the two boys that work down cleaning at the courthouse.
McNeil, I don't know nobody.
You know who I'm talking about. Used to be Brownie's old lady. You know Brownie was standing there trying to help her raise them two boys. One of them got an old funny shaped head.
Oh, yeah, I know who you're talking about.
But that boy come by here a little while ago this morning. The oldest one. He can't be no more than 16 or 17 at the most. He come by here asking to carry him on a trip to the north side. Then he said he got to make a stop on White Side Road. I carried him up there, then he go in one of his houses and come out carrying the television. He ain't said nothing about no television. I told him it was going to cost him $2 more for me to be hauling around the television. Had me carry him over on the north side to the pawn shop. Now I know the boy that stole the television, but I ain't saying nothing. I just want my money. Come on back and stop at Pat's place to give me some tobacco. And the fella standing around just happened to mention the name of this woman who had her television stolen. Man, don't you know this boy went and stole his grandmama's television? Name is Bulger, Miss Sarah Bulger. That's old lady McNeil's mother. I used to carry the church before she got too old to go. Still his own grandmother's television.
Man, that ain't nothing, Turnbull. I seen worse than that.
Yeah, I have too. But what would make someone want to steal their grandmama's television? I can't figure it out. Becca, you know McNeil would live up on Webster. Used to be Brownie's old lady. Worked clean up at the courthouse. Got the two boys. One got funny shaped head.
I don't want to hear that, Turnbull. I got other things on my mind. Yeah, she. These Lucille's numbers. I hear Pope done here.
Yeah, it's pretty big. Say, Becca, I've been meaning to ask you. I got a nephew that's trying to make something of himself. You reckon you'd be able to get him down at the mill?
don't know if they hiring, but I'll check into it. I know some people down there be able to take care of what you're hiring. I can't promise nothing, but I'll talk to them.
Thanks, Becker. His name is Robert Sheely. He's trying to straighten himself out, and I told his mama I'd check around and see what I can do. Thanks again. Here goes your message.
Hey, you don't know nothing about Sheely's nephew, do you? I can tell that. The biggest rogue you ever seen. What, the biggest thug? What? He down there in the workhouse. He was, him and the Jigger Boys the one that broke in the tape.
Ain't nobody asked you nothing. Like an old lady, always gossiping, running off the
mind. I just talking what I know.
Say, Becca, I see you got some new ties.
Hey, yeah, I got two. I'm gonna get two more next week. Car service. Wooster Street? Yeah, I know where it's at. All right, black car.
Man, Cigar Andy standing up in the middle of Robert Street cussing out everybody.
Oh, yeah. Who's she mad at now?
She started with God and went on down the list. She cussing out the mayor, Doc Goldblum, Mr. Eli, her landlord, the light man, gas man, telephone man, and anybody else she can think of. They got her furniture and everything sitting out on the sidewalk.
I knew it was going to come to that. Everybody else done moved out of that place 2 months ago. That'd be able to pick up deal for 2 years.
Man, she's standing up there in the middle of the street raising up her dress.
I bet she ain't got no drawers.
She had traffic backed up. Almost got hit by a milk truck. Man, the car's trying to go around, but she won't let. Just standing in the middle of the street raising up her dress.
Ugh, I don't know what she doing that for. She ain't got nothing nobody want. Now, Perlene get out there and raise up her dress. That'd be another thing. You have a ride on your hands. They ought to put Cigar Annie and make you her ass do vision both.
There ain't nothing wrong with Cigar Annie. They had off in Mayfield 2 or 3 times. They figure anybody who cuss out God and don't care who's listening got to be crazy. They found out she got more sense than they do. And that's why they let her out. She raising her dress, because that's all anybody ever wanted from her since she was 12. She saying, if y'all want it, it is!
She sent out an SOS, that's what she doing.
Yeah. Turbo, you know, sometimes I don't know why I try to talk to you. Next time, remind me to shut up.
Say, Peter's been by here?
No, I ain't seen her.
I'll be over at Clippers if she comes.
And when you gonna work on my car? I thought you was gonna take a look at my car.
I can't take a look at it today. I have to do it tomorrow.
Hey, you want to bring me back some coffee?
I ain't no slave. Walk over and get your own coffee.
That boy got no sense.
He's all right. He's just young. He got a lot to learn. That gal keep after him. He'll be all right.
He don't need that girl. He don't know how to treat her. You treat her like the kind of class he is.
You don't know what nobody needs. Let that boy alone live his life. Ain't nobody told you what you need. Always talking about something.
That ain't what I'm saying. You know that girl gonna see past that boy going to somebody got some sense to treat her right. Somebody got more respect for it than me messing around with her own sister.
You don't know what you're talking about.
You see me asking about it. I seen her riding around this car here lately. She come by here and they go off, run around together. They don't even try to hide.
That don't mean nothing, because they ride in a car.
You be calling on the phone. I know what I see, and I know what I'm talking about. You watch, that girl will see right fast.
Well, let him find that out. He's got his own way to come to things. That's all I'm saying. Let the boy live and let him alone.
I ain't messing with him. I just say he ain't got no sense. I believe he got shell shocked over there in Vietnam.
Turnbull, you mess with anybody that you get a chance to put your nose in their business. Let that boy live his life.
Remember that boy used to be around here? What's his name, Jasper? That's it. Fool went crazy and jumped off the IRA car and set up my house. I told you about him when I first seen him. I told you he ain't had no sense, and I'm telling you about this boy now. And you want to call to put my nose in folks' business, but you mark my words. I just live and let live. But damn if I can't talk to express an opinion, same as everybody else, without folks accusing me of being tied up in folks' business. I just talk what I know. Just like I told you, Phil wanted to come back with your $4. He out somewhere getting drunk. I told him not to give it to him.
Now see, there you go, messing in people's business. I ain't giving nothing. I loaned him.
Hey, I'm just saying.
That's my business about what he paid me.
Car service.
Yeah, you just say it to yourself.
All right, brown car, you be ready, because I ain't waiting.
Young blood enters carrying a cup of coffee.
Here. What's that for?
That's your coffee, nigga.
told me to get my home. How you know I ain't send somebody else?
Oh, nigga, take this coffee and give me my 30 cent.
Ring. Ring.
Car service. Where you at? I thought you was going with me down to the furniture store. What's wrong with your hair? Nothing wrong with your hair. Rudy say something was wrong with your hair. No, I ain't told her. I'm gonna wait till everything's set. What time are you gonna be done? All right, I'll pick you up at 3 o'clock. Mr. Harper, please. Darnell Williams. Mr. Harper, this is Darnell Williams. I'm calling about the house under the GI Bill. You said to call to get a closing date. A title search? I thought they had a title. No. I can understand that, but I thought all of that was taken care of by the down payment. Well, how much? That's all I have to do. Ain't nothing else gonna come up.
2 weeks? It take that long?
No, there's no doubt I'll have it for you tomorrow. Yes, sir. I'll have it.
Youngblood takes out his notebook. He looks to see how much money he has. Obviously, he doesn't have enough. He sits, thinks, and suddenly an idea occurs to him. He snaps close to his notebook, and then he gets up and exits. The lights are still behind him.
Lights up come up on Jitney Station early afternoon. The radio is playing. Becker sits at his desk reading a newspaper. Turnbull sits downstage of him reading a Playboy magazine. He holds up the magazine for Becker to see.
Hey, look at this one, Becker.
Yeah.
Ooh, what a man would do it that. If I get up to heaven and she ain't dead, I'm gonna ask God to send me straight to hell.
Turnbull. Give me my 30 cents.
30 cents you talking about?
For the coffee. You know what I'm talking about.
Oh, there it is. The coffee over there. I ain't touched it.
I know you better give me my 30 cents.
Well, I ain't stuck.
You asked me to get you a cup of coffee and now you ain't gonna pay me?
Give the man his money, Turbo.
I ain't giving him nothing.
Look, I ain't gonna have his dissension in here. Give the man his money.
Yeah, here. Here's the 30 cent.
Pick it up.
It's yours, you pick it up.
I ain't throw it down there.
Well, let it lay there then. I'm through with it.
All right, let it lay there then. But before this day is over with, I'm gonna pick up my 30 cents.
Here's your 30 cents. Here, you satisfied?
Ring.
That's my trip.
You know that's his trip, Turnbull.
I thought he just came back from a trip.
He had to go downtown to take care of some business. You know everything else, I'm surprised he didn't know that.
Yeah, okay, red shirt.
We ain't got no good sense.
If you leave it to you, ain't nobody got no sense.
Damn! What sense it make for that McNeil boy to steal his grandmama's television? What sense it make for Sheely's nephew to break into Taylor's bar? What sense it make for that boy to run with his girlfriend's sister? Half these niggas around here run no empty, and that boy at the top of the list.
Turbo, sometimes you act like a little kid. Look, if Lucille called, tell her I'm picking up the groceries. If you pass a car wash, you might want to stop in and get that car washed, since it may haul people around a dirty car.
Car service. Youngblood, he ain't here. Who does it? Feeds him? Yeah, I thought it was you. No, Youngblood ain't here. Pick you up at 4, that's what you're going to tell him. Okay. I'll tell him. Yep.
Hey, Mr. Turnbull, Darnell around here?
He went on a trip.
He say when he coming back?
He'll be back in a minute. You might as well wait on him. How you doing? You don't come by here too much no more. I remember you used to come by all the time to get that baby some milk. But I know he getting big now. How old is he now?
2. Going on 3, running around and trying to talk.
Time just keep going. They don't wait on nobody. Everything changed. Baby, mama raised you right, girl. You got diapers. Time sure fly, girl. Your mama did a good job raising you. You can tell that right off. It ain't easy these days to raise a child, though, you know. I don't know what's in these young boys' heads these days. Seem like they don't respect nobody. They don't even respect themselves. I'll come along. You know, that was the first thing you learned. If you ain't respect yourself, quite naturally, you couldn't have the respect of nobody else. When I was coming along, more respect you had for other people. The more people respected you, seemed like you came back to your double. These young boys don't know nothing about that, and it's gonna take them a lifetime to find out. They disrespect everybody and don't think nothing about it. They steady on grandmama's television. Get a hold of one woman, time another one body, grab a hold of her, they don't even care who it is. It could be anybody. I just try and live and let live. My grandma was like that. She the one that raised me. You know, she wouldn't let you lie. That was about the worst you could be. A liar didn't know the truth and was never gonna find out. And everybody knows the truth will set you free. Now, I ain't trying to get all the bitters in that. Like I say, I just did and let live. But some things just come up when you're wrong, and you gotta say something, otherwise you just throw your whole life off balance. I know you don't wanna hear this, Rena, but you don't need no high-headed young boy like young blood. What you need is somebody level-headed, who know how to respect and appreciate a woman. I can see the kind of woman he is. You ain't the kind of woman for young blood. He ain't the kind of man for you. You need a more mature, responsible man.
I don't think so.
You just wait a while. You sound right. I done seen many a girl wake up when it's too late. Don't you be like that. You go and find yourself a man and know how to treat you. You don't need nobody running the street all hours of day and night. You ain't that kind of woman.
Darnell don't run no streets. I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, I see. Mm-hmm. Run around with other women. I see him with your sister all the time. Ring. Day and night.
Wow. Your phone's ringing.
I ain't trying to get your business now. I'm telling you this for your own good. If you were some other kind of woman, I wouldn't be wasting my time.
Look, I gotta go. Tell Darnell I was about to see him.
Is this all? Car service. Becker? Oh, hey, Lucille, he's not here right now. He said tell you he's going to pick up some groceries. Okay, I'll tell him.
Feeling him back here?
I ain't seen him. I told you he laid up somewhere drunk on your $4. You ain't gonna see him until he's sober.
Man, these white folks are slick. They think all kinds of ways to take your money.
If you just not finding that out, then God help, but you don't know.
Darnell, I need to see you.
Man, what you want to see me about? I'm working, woman. I told you about coming by my work.
It's your trip, Turbo. Mm-hmm. I just came back, then. Get up.
Hey, hey. Yeah, car service. Brown car. You be ready now, because I ain't going to wait.
Darnell, I don't understand. I'm trying so hard. I'm doing everything I can to try and make this work.
What? What's the matter?
I'm down there doing my little job at the restaurant. Going to college, trying to take care of Jesse, trying to take care of your needs, and trying to keep this house together. I'm trying to do everything to make things better. Now, I go home, because I gotta go to the store, and I go upstairs and look in the drawer, and the food money is gone. Now, you explain that to me. There was $80 in that drawer that ain't in there now.
I needed it. I'm going to put it back.
What you need it for? Tell me that. What's more important than me and Jesse eating?
I had to pay a debt. I'm going to put it back.
You know I don't touch the food money. Whatever we do, whatever happens, we got to eat. If I need clothes, I go without. My little personal things, I go without. If I ain't got no electricity, I go without. Because I ain't going to be that irresponsible to my child. I ain't gonna be like that because he depends on me. I'm not gonna be that irresponsible to my family. Ain't gonna be like that. Jesse's gonna have a chance at life. He ain't gonna be up late at night, unable to sleep because his mama went and spent the food money on some nail polish or some afro sheen. He ain't gonna be up and unable to sleep because his daddy spent the grocery money to pay some debt.
Aw, woman, I'm trying to do what's right and this is what I get.
You know what you be doing better than I, but whatever it is ain't enough.
What you talking about now? I told you I'm gonna put the damn money back.
It ain't all about the money, Darnell. It's the way you've been doing. You ain't never home no more.
I be working. You know I'm out here hustling. I got two jobs looking for three.
You be out half the night. I wake up and you ain't there.
That's what time people say come to work. 2 a.m. I can't tell UPS what to do. What time to have people come to work. Told you that when I took the job. Told you I wouldn't be home. You said, okay. Now you want to come at me about not being home? Man, you know where I'm at.
You say you working for UPS, but I don't ever see no UPS money.
I had to pay a debt. I told you that too. I
Told you I wouldn't see no money from the wall.
What kind of debt?
Look, baby, just hang in there with me a while, okay? Just a minute.
I've been hanging in there with you, Darnell. That's what you said the last time. Hang with me and it'll turn around. Well, when's it gonna turn around, Darnell?
Soon, baby, soon. Just a while, just hang with me.
I just want you to know that I ain't no fool, Darnell. I know you've been running around with Peaches and her crew at all hours of the night doing whatever it is you be doing. I may not know everything, but I know y'all doing something.
Who told you that? Who told you me and Peaches doing what?
She's my sister, Darnell. Don't you think I can tell when she's trying to hide something from me?
Hide what? What you talking about? Hide what? What's she trying to hide?
Ain't no use in you bothering yourself to come home tonight, because I just may not be there when you get there.
She slams the door as she exits. The phone rings. Youngblood starts to go after her, changes his mind. Comes back, stands in the middle of the room, perplexed. Suddenly, he takes his notebook from his pocket and throws it on the floor. He regains his composure, picks up the book, and exits. Becker enters on the fourth. Ring.
Car service. Jimmie don't work here.
I was just talking to Clifford next door. He said a man gonna board up his place next month.
Yeah, I know. The man from the city was by here 2 weeks ago, too. They gonna tear it all down, this whole block.
Then that man was here, and you ain't told nobody what he said.
They gonna board the place up first of the month.
Well, why the hell didn't you tell somebody?
I'm telling you now.
Fine time to tell me 2 weeks later. It ain't like that's a small piece of news. I got rent to pay. Doctor bills, every man in here, depending on the station for their livelihood. The city's gonna board it up. You know for 2 weeks. And you ain't bothered to get around to telling nobody that ain't like you better. What are we gonna do now in the 2 weeks we got?
I don't know. I kinda figure we all just go in together somewhere else or find another place, but I don't know now.
I'm just tired, though.
I can't hardly explain it now. You look up one day and all you got left is what you ain't spent. Every day costs you something and you don't all the time realize it. You know, I used to question God about everything. Why he hardened Pharaoh's heart. Why he let Jacob steal his brother's birthright. After Corrine died, I told myself I wasn't going to ask no more questions. But the answers didn't matter. They didn't matter right then. I thought that would change, but it never, never did change. Still don't matter after all these years. It doesn't look like it's ever gonna matter. I'm tired of waiting for God to decide whether he wants to hold my hand. I've been running cars out of here for 18 years. I just think I'm tired of driving.
I've been with you for 12 of them 18 years. And I would have thought that you would have told me that I was gonna move because they're boarding up the station.
I'm telling you now.
And that ain't what I mean, Becca. It's like you're just a shadow of yourself. The station been gone downhill. Some people overcharge, some people don't haul. Field and stay drunk. I just watch you and you don't do nothing.
What's to be done, huh? I try to keep cars running out of here, keep everybody happy. I post the rates up on the board. If somebody charge extra and people complain, I give the difference and tell the driver about it. I ain't gonna put nobody out unless they totally irresponsible. As for Field and I don't let them drink in here. But I can tell you that man, he got his own personal business. I can't tell that unless people start complaining.
Complain? Hell, they don't do no complaining. They call somebody else. Somebody asks them for the number. They don't call the court 19802. They give them somebody else's number. Complain? You think they're going to call you up and complain? Nigga, they don't even know you alive.
I just do the best I can do.
Well, sometimes your best ain't enough. Turbo. They boarding up the station the first of the month. Becker talking about quitting. So we ought to start thinking about moving somewhere or getting over somebody else.
Who boarded up the station?
The city. They fixing to tear the whole block down. Clifford and everybody got their notices. The man was by here 2 weeks ago.
So that's what they was doing. I seen them snooping around here. Told me they was conducting a survey. Well, what were we gonna do? Becker, you quitting?
I ain't said I was quitting.
That's what you told me.
Well, I said I was thinking about it.
Well, we ought to have a meeting and figure out exactly what we're going to do.
They can never leave well enough alone. Car service. I even see him. He's here. Just a minute. Barry. He won't be satisfied till they tear the whole goddamn neighborhood down.
Back in here. Yeah, I know, Lucille. Tomorrow. I thought it wasn't gonna be until next month. But who called? Are you sure? Yeah. Well, okay. I'll talk to you.
They gonna board the place up tomorrow?
My boy's getting out tomorrow.
Lights go down.
Act 1, Scene 3. Lights come up at Jitney Station early the following morning. It's obvious Youngblood has spent the night there. He sits on the couch, figuring out in his notebook. He hears Turnbull put the key in the deadbolt and hurries to put his shirt on. Turnbull enters with a cup of coffee.
What are you getting out today?
Yeah, getting out of where?
You don't know about Baker's son?
I know what?
Ouch. Baker's son been in penitentiary for 20 years. He getting out today.
I didn't even know Becca had a son.
Been in penitentiary for 20 years. Right down there at Western State Pen. Becca ain't even been down there to see him once.
Mm. Yeah?
I think it's a shame. Becca just wrote him off his list.
Yeah, well, that's his business, I guess.
Hell, that's his own son. If he ain't gonna stand by him, who's gonna? He ain't got nobody else. He killed his mama. Lucille ain't none of his mama. His mama died about a month after he went in. When the judge sentenced him to the electric chair, his mama just fell dead away. They brought her home, put her in the bed, and she stayed right there until she died.
Give him the electric chair?
That's right. Sure did. I was there. He later got it commuted to life.
What did he do to get the electric chair?
Let's see, Becker's boy. Clarence is an actor. He, everybody called him Booster. See, Booster liked that science. But everybody, you know, they know he was in the science fair over there at the Boo Hill Planetarium every year. Where they have all them science experiments, where they make the water run uphill and things like that. Booster won first place 3 years in a row. He the only one who ever did that. I can't even count how many times he had his picture in the paper. They let him into the University of Pittsburgh. You know, back then, they didn't have too many colored out there. But they was trying to catch up to the Russians, and they didn't care if he was colored or not. Gave him a scholarship and everything. Becker was just as proud as he could be. Him and Booster was always close. Becker used to take him hunting down around Wheeling, West Virginia. They go hunting and fishing. Becker didn't have but one boy. After he was born, the doctor told his wife that if she had another one, it was liable to kill her. Say she was lucky to have one. Anyway, Booster goes out to pick there and he meet this old white girl, young girl, about 18 she was. Of course, Booster wasn't about 19 himself. Now, our old man was some kind of big shot down there at Gulf War, had a lot of money, and then bought the girl a car for her birthday. Booster and that girl, they just go everywhere together. She ride him around like she was his chauffeur. Of course, she let him drive it too. I believe he drove him more than she did. That girl was crazy about Booster. And they was just sneaking around, you know? She didn't want her daddy to know she was fooling around with a color boy. But one day, see her father was up here in the neighborhood looking for one of them whores. He found one and she told him to drive him to the dead-end street there by the school so she could turn the trick in the car. Don't you know they put a white in the back of that girl's car? And he goes over and look inside there, Booster, just banging the hell out of his head. Give it to him. That cracker went crazy. He just couldn't stand the sight of Booster screwing that girl with the yanking open the car door. Booster didn't know who he was. All he knew was some crazy white man to open the door and was screaming his head off. He proceeded to beat that man half to death. To get to the short of it, the police came and that girl said she was driving downtown on her way home from a movie. And when she stopped for a red light, Booster jumped in her car and made her drive up there on the dead end street. Where he raped. They arrested Booster and Becker got him out on bail because he knew the girl was lying. The first day he was out, the first day, he went over to that girl's house and shot her dead right on the front
door. Served the bitch right?
What you talking about? I knew you had no sense. I don't know why I tried talking to you.
Served her right for lying.
There ain't no cause to kill nobody. I don't care if she was lying. See, that's what's wrong with you young folks. Don't take time to stop and think before you speak. Serve the bitch right. That's all you know.
It does.
Fool, what are you talking about? That boy had no right to kill that girl.
She lied on him, didn't she?
That girl you got a right to kill you because you lying to her?
We ain't talking about me. Stay out of my business.
Your business already in the street. Everybody know you misused that girl, keeping her tied up in the house with that baby while you run around with her sister. And you don't give her 2 pennies to buy the baby no milk.
Hey, man, you stay the fuck out of my business.
Oh, now you want to beat me up for telling the truth. Well, go ahead. I'm an old man. Go ahead and make you proud of you, an old man. I done told you your business in the street.
Young Buck punches him in the face.
Stay the fuck out of my bed.
Hey, hey, what's going on?
This motherfucker got his nose all up in my bed. I don't get in his business, and I damn sure don't want him in mine.
Hold it. You know what I'm already told you. What's going on?
This motherfucker got his nose all up in my bed.
Let him go, Becky. Let him go. I ain't scared of him. All I did was tell him where his business was. No.
Let me go, Becky. Let me go.
Hold it, girl. Brother, there ain't going to be no more fighting up in here, now. Now, Turbo, you just gonna get out of here. I got him.
I got it to you, boy. Hitting an old man like that. Can't have you fighting and causing trouble. You and Turbo don't get along. Just don't speak to him.
I don't want him speaking, rooming, and talking shit about my business. That's all. That's all I want.
Turbo comes in rushing. He rushes in with the gun. He comes in and he's rushing in.
Come on, hold on. This is what you're looking for?
What?
You think I'm lying, huh? Come on,
put the gun up, Turbo.
I'll tell you something else, I had that girl of yours.
You lying, motherfucker?
Wait, come on, jump at me. Jump at me, you're not pulling your ass to keep
it. You lying? Why you want to tell the boy to lie like that? The girl ain't giving you the time of day.
You think I'm lying? I'll tell you how much I'm lying. Stay out of this shit, man.
No, don't you lie to the boy like that. Now, come on, now, put the gun up.
Just because you used to them low-life women don't mean everybody else is.
Keep it up.
Look, you don't want to do that now. It ain't worth all that. Come on, Turbo. Come on. The boy.
Boy, you got one more time. You got one more time.
He just showed. Yeah, no, it don't matter. Now, don't do nothing that you're going to be regretting. Now, go on, now, Turbo. Go on.
Trips out of here. I done told him time and again about that drinking.
What are you
talking about? I paid my monthly dues, and the money ain't up yet. I ain't going nowhere.
Here's your money. There's your money. Take it and get out of here.
I ain't taking nothing. I paid for 2 more weeks, and 2 more weeks is what I get.
Look, there's your money. Now we straight. Car service. 2709 Francis Street. Project. Be right there. Turnbull, take this trip.
That's my trip, Turnbull.
I done told you, you ain't running no more trips out of this station. Now get your money and get out of here.
Who the hell do you think you are? You ain't running over me, Becker.
You can take your money and get out of here. Go on, Turnbull.
I don't get this. Ain't none of my business. Well, I'll take
it. This is a free country.
You just be going when I get back.
I'm a free man. You can't tell me what to do. This is the United States of America. You see that, Turnbull? You see that?
Lights go down. Act 1, Scene 4. Lights come up on Jitney Station a half an hour later. The radio is playing. Distant thunder is heard. Turnbull and Fielding have been joined by Booster, who stands smoking. Looking out the window, he is dressed in his prison-issue suit.
Yeah, I know your daddy real good. I've been driving Jitney with him for 8 years now, and I worked on and off with him when he was down at the mill. That was when I was young. Here, get yourself a little nip.
No thanks. You said he'd be back any minute?
He just went on a short trip. He'll be back in no time. They ain't a chance the last time you've seen him, I reckon.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, they tearing everything down around here. All along Valley there. You see that tore everything down. They gonna tear this building down. They gonna board it up first of the month. We about to move. Either that or split up. Can't stay here no more.
You got to have somebody you can count on, you know? Now my wife, we've been separated for 22 years now. But I ain't never loved nobody the way I love that woman. You know what I mean?
I guess.
She the only thing in the world that I got. I had a dream once. It just touched me so. I was climbing this ladder. It was a solid gold ladder, and I was climbing up the hill. I get to the top of the ladder, and I could see all the saints sitting around. And I could see her too, sitting there in a place of glory. Just as I reached the top, my hands started to slip, and I called out for help. All of the saints and angels, Saint Peter and everybody. They just sat there, looked at me. She was the only one who left her seat in glory and tried to help me from falling back down that ladder. I ain't never forget that. When I woke up, tears was all over my face, just running all down in my ears, and I lay there and cried like a baby. Because that meant so much to me to find out that after all these years that she still loved me.
You know what, that's some heavy drama.
Oh, she love me all right. I know she do. I ain't seen that woman in 22 years, but I know she love me. Hey, Becca, I was just trying to talk. I was talking to your son.
Thought I told you not to be here when I got back.
All right, Becca, you win. I'm gone.
Here, take your money with you.
Let me work 2 weeks. I'll be sober in the morning. It's almost over, Becca. It's almost over.
Go on home, Fielding. I'll see you tomorrow. You just be sober when you get back here.
Well, how you doing?
Look good.
Yeah, I feel pretty good. Lucille told me you'd be down here.
Turnbull, go on next door and tell Clifford to give me a fist sandwich. So, doing all right?
Yeah, I don't know. I've been looking around, and I don't know what to think. People going everywhere, all up and down. Dogs and cats and airplanes. It's taking me a while to get used to things.
So, what you gonna do with the rest of your life now you're gonna ruin it?
Hey, Pop. No, I just came by to say hi, man.
Can't get no job. Who gonna hire you? Got a mark on you a foot wide. They can see you coming. Just took your life and just threw it away. Like it wasn't.
I don't want all this. I don't want to hear about my life being ruined. I just stopped by to say hi. I don't want all this. I done paid my debt.
Well, you don't even know where your debt began.
Well, I know where it ended. It ended after I did that 20 years. Now, I don't owe nobody nothing. They tried to give me that parole 5 years ago, and I turned it down because I didn't want to owe nobody nothing. I ain't want nobody looking after me, telling me what to do, asking me questions about my life. Now, I'm walking here to say hi, and you start telling me my life is ruined. How I'm going to get a job. But, Pop, I don't want that. I'm a grown man. I'm 39 years old. I'm young. I'm healthy. I ain't got no complaints. And I don't carry no grudges. Whatever's between us these 20 years, I put aside. I don't hold no grudges.
Who the hell care what you hold?
I'm the one got to walk around here with people pointing at me. Talking about me behind my back. There go his father. That's him. Trying to sneak a peek at me out the corner of their eye. See if they can see something wrong with me. See if they can see what kind of man would raise a boy to do something like that. You done marked me, and you walk around here talking about you ain't got no
I'm
brush.
Just saying I don't have no hard feelings. You didn't come see me, Pop. Now, I've been thinking about my life and all the things you gave me and all the things you did for me. All the things
Everything I give you, you threw away. You ain't got nothing now. You got less than the day you was born. Then you had some dignity, some innocence. You ain't got nothing now. You took it through it all away. You're 39 years old and you ain't got nothing.
No, Pop, you wrong. Now, I may have lost some things, I may have missed some things, but that don't mean I ain't got nothing.
You ain't got nothing, boy.
Well, since we talking about what you got, Pop, you the boss of a Jitney station.
Yeah, I am a boss of a Jitney station. I'm a deacon down at the church. Got me a little house. That may not be much, but it's mine. I worked 27 years at the mill. Got me a pension. I got a wife. I got respect. I can walk anywhere and hold my head up high. What I ain't got is a son that did me honor. The Bible said, honor your father and your mother. That ain't what I got. I ain't got a son I can be proud of. That ain't what I got. A son to come up behind me. Living a good, honest, decent life. I got a son who people point to and say, that's Becker's boy, the one that killed that girl. That's Becker's boy, the one they gave the electric chair to. That's Becker's boy.
I did what I had to do when I paid
for it. What you had to do? What you had to do? What law say is that you have to kill somebody to tell a lie on you? What does it say that? If somebody tell a lie on you, you gonna have to kill them? Who taught you that? It was a lie. That gal told a lie, and if it was the truth, then you go ahead and kill yourself. Go on and throw your life away. But it was a lie. We could have fought the lie. I had already lined up a lawyer together. We could have fought that
a
lie.
A lawyer wasn't going to make no difference. I wasn't going to the penitentiary for nothing. I wasn't going to live a lie.
No, I taught you two wrongs don't make a right.
Sometimes they do. Sometimes you got to add it up that way. Otherwise, it's just one wrong after another, and you never get to what's right. Now, I wasn't going to hang no sign on my neck to say rape.
Oh, you're going to hang a sign and say murder. That's bad.
But that's honest.
That girl lying on you didn't make you wrong in the world. A lie don't make you wrong in the world.
It don't make you right either. Right is right and wrong, no wrong. And right is right and wrong.
Well, I taught you to respect.
Why, Pops, man?
I taught you that all of life is precious.
Well, listen, man. You taught me a lot of things. You taught me a lot of things, but you know what? A lot of things I had to learn on my own. Like that time Mr. Grant came to the house to collect rent when we was 2 months behind. Now, I don't remember what year it was, I just know it was when. Grandma Ada had just died and you got behind in the rent because you had to help pay for a funeral. Now, I don't know if you knew it, Pop, but you was a big man. Everywhere you went, people treated you like a big man. You used to walk and take me to the barbershop with you. You walk in there and fill up the whole place. Everybody stopped cussing because Jim Becker had walked in. And I wanted to be like that. I used to look at you and wonder how you could be so big. I would go to school and I'd try to be like that, but I never could. And I told myself, that's all right. One day, I'm going to be like that. And I'm going to be able to walk into the barbershop and everybody stop and look at me. That day when Mr. Rand came to the house, it was snowing. You came out on the porch and he started shouting and cussing and threatening to put us out on a corner on the street where we belong. And I was waiting on you to tell him to shut up and get off your porch. But you just looked at him and promised you would have his money next month.
Mama came to the door, Mr. Rand just kept shouting and cussing, and I looked at Mama, she was trying to get me to go in the house, and I looked at you. And you had got smaller. Like the longer he shouted, the smaller you got, and when we went back to the barbershop, you didn't seem so big no more. You was the same size as everybody else. You was just another man in the barbershop. That's when I told myself, if I ever got that big, it wouldn't be nothing that was gonna make me small. And that's when I met Susan McKnight and found out her daddy was the vice president of golf. Oh, that's when I got big. That made me a big man. I felt like I was somebody. I felt like I could walk in the barbershop and fill it up the way you did. And when she told daddy lie on me, that's when I woke up. That's when I realized that I wasn't big from the inside. I wasn't big on my own. When she told me that lie on me, it made me small. And I wanted to do something and said, I just wasn't another nigga. Then I was Clarence Becker. I wanted to make them remember my name, and I thought about you standing there getting small and Mr. Rand shouting and Susan McKnight shouting in that lie, and I realized it was my chance to make the biggest big again. My chance to show what I learned on my own. And I thought you would understand. I thought you'd be proud of me, Pop.
I'm proud of you for killing somebody, huh?
No, Pop, for being a warrior, for dealing with the world in ways you couldn't or wouldn't, or didn't.
You're trying to say I had something to do with you pulling that trigger? You're trying to say that it's my fault because I didn't knock Mr. Rand on his ass so I could keep a roof over your head so you wouldn't have to sleep in the street in the cold and the snow?
No, Pop, I didn't.
No, you going to knock Mr. Rand on his ass for me by killing that guy.
Pop, it was for me. I did it for myself, but it didn't add up the way I thought it would. I was wrong, but you see, I can see that now.
You had every advantage. I tried to fix it so you didn't have to follow up behind me. So you could go on and go further. So you could have a better life. I did what I thought you could have.
Hey, Pop. Now you look down your road. You made your choices. You done what was right for you. I made my choice. I took my role and I did what was right for you. I paid the consequences. Now it's over and done. Let's just say I stopped by to say hi.
You know why I never came to see you?
No, I don't want to know, and that's your
business. I kept seeing your face at your mother's funeral. How you just stood there, never shed a tear. Stood there with a scowl on your face. And now you want to come in here and ridicule me because I didn't knock Mr. Rand on his ass? You want to know why? Tell you why. Because I had your black ass crying to be fed, crying to have a roof over your head, to have clothes to wear to school, lunch money in your pocket. That's why. Because I had a family. I had responsibility. If I'd have knocked him on his ass, you wouldn't have to go home. You wouldn't have had no clothes on your back or a roof over your head. I done what I had to do. I swallowed my pride. Let him mess over me. All the time saying, you bastards got to come. Look out. Becker's boy coming to straighten this shit out. You're not going to fuck over him. He's going to grow big and strong. Watch out for him. Because Becker's boy is going to stride through this shit like Daniel in the Lion's team. You watch out for Becker's boy and what I get. You tell me what I get. Tell me what I get. What I get, huh? No, no, you just stay away from me. What I get, huh? What I get, you tell me. I get a murderer. That's what. A murderer.
Look, man,
and the way your mama loved you, you killed her. You know that? You a double murderer.
I didn't kill her, Pop. Now you know that, man.
What you call it then? That woman took sick the day the judge sentenced you, and she ain't never walked or said another word or ate anything for 23 days. She just laid up there in that room until she died. Now you tell me that ain't killing her. Tell me that ain't killing her.
Day mama came to the courtroom by herself, where were you? Anybody can see it was wearing her down. Where were you when she needed somebody to hold her hand? When she needed a shoulder to cry on? Somebody to talk to? Where was you? Not for me, but for her. The woman she loved. When she fainted in that courtroom, I tried to get to her. But I had 6 deputies holding me back. What was holding you back? What was you in 23 days when she was dying?
I was trying to keep her alive, trying to get her to get something to eat, trying to get her to wake
up. No, 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 it wasn't about eating, Pop. That's not what she needed, a bowl of soup. She didn't know that you weren't there for her, that you would be there for when she got up, and she can count on you to support her. But you turned your back, clinging to your rules.
There's nothing about me turning my back.
What you call
it? I was there. I was holding her hand when she died. Where was you? Locked up in a cage like some animal. That's what killed her. To hear the judge say that the life she brought into the world was unfit to live. That you be remanded to the custody of the Commissioner of Correction at Western State Penitentiary and there to be executed in the electric chair. This order to be carried out 30 days from today. Ain't that what the judge said? Ain't that what she heard? This order to be carried out 30 days from today. That's what killed her. She didn't want to live them 30 days. She didn't want to be allowed to hear on the 11 o'clock news that they had killed you. So don't you say nothing to me about me turning my back. When I nursed that woman, talked to her, held her hand, prayed over her, and the last words that come out of her mouth was your name. What was you, Mr. Murderer? Mr. Unfit to Live Amongst Society? Where was you when your mama was dying and calling your name? You are my son. I helped bring you into this world. From this moment on, I'm calling the deal off. You ain't nothing to me, boy. You ain't nothing to me but another nigga on the street.
The phone rings. Lights go black. End of act one.
So thank you, Dr. Black. Without further ado, we'll go ahead and get started with action.
Two, scene one. Lights come up on Jitney Station. Dub is sweeping, picking up cigarette butts and putting them in an ashtray. Turnbow sits at the table looking at a magazine.
I hear something y'all don't understand. You know, how come everybody says she's pretty? I hear some people say she's the prettiest woman in the world.
I ain't gonna say all that, but she right up there.
She ain't pretty as Sarah Vaughan.
No, we talking about Lena Horne. Some things just ain't open to debate. Lena Horne been pretty is one of them.
Sarah Vaughan got more nature.
Now what's that supposed to mean? And even if she do, how you gonna measure it? It ain't like she got more hair or something.
She got a prettier smile too. A lot of people sleeping on Sarah Vaughan.
Now how do you know how many people sleeping with her?
I said sleeping on her, not with her. Everybody talking about Lena Horne and people sleeping on Sarah Vaughan. People don't know Sarah Vaughan got more everything than Lena Horne. They just believe what they hear. But Sarah Vaughan got more nature. Got a prettier smile. Got more personality. And she can sing better.
No, we ain't said nothing about that. We ain't said nothing about singing. You said Lena Horne wasn't pretty.
She ain't. She ain't as pretty as people think. People just think she pretty.
Oh, I see. People just think dogs bite. People just think you cut yourself, you bleed. Hey, Phil, Turbo say Lena Horne ain't pretty.
Some people say shit don't stink. Sooner or later, they gonna find out otherwise. It's them pretty women like Lena Horne get a man killed.
You ain't got to be pretty to get a man killed. Any woman would get a man killed if he ain't careful. Am I right, Doug?
Yeah, you're right. And that's why I don't talk about women. I don't talk about money either. And them is the two things you never hear me talk about much. And them is the two things that most people get killed for.
Women and money will get a preacher killed.
Mm-hmm. I've seen it happen. Now you go ask one of them fellas, say, what'd you do? I mean, you have to catch them after they cool down. You know, you have to get them down there in the jail after they've been there for about 6 or 9 months. And you ask them, you say, hey, why'd you kill so-and-so? And he'll tell you. He'll tell you, he had a woman stay on his mind and he couldn't think right. And then, when he seen somebody else talking to him, seemed like they was the cause of all his troubles. And there wasn't nothing left to do but to kill him. Now, see, and that's why if you see me talking to a woman, you can bet it's my sister or my aunt.
You're right. First thing a man do when he get a woman, he don't want nobody else to have it. He say, this is mine. I'm going to hold on to this. If I'm going over to see Betty Jean, but I'm going to hold on to this. If I catch anybody sneaking around here sniffing, I'm going to bust his nose and break both his legs if I don't shoot him with my .44. He say that, then he going over to see Betty Jean. He don't know some fella that said the same thing about catching somebody around Betty Jean. That fella, he go over to see Betty Sue while this other fella sniff around his Betty Jean. Sooner or later, somebody going to get their wires crossed. Somebody going to see Betty Sue when he should have been seeing Betty Jean. That'll be all she wrote for him. The only thing left to do is write on his tombstone. Here lies Bubba Boo, was caught with Betty Jean, instead of Betty Sue.
Yeah, boy, they got a lot of it. They got a lot of that on a whole lot of tombstone.
Yeah. Car service. Yeah? Sure, I'll tell them. Turn them. That was on Lil. She said you're supposed to take her to the doctor's. Oh, shit. You know she's been doing Jehovah's Witnesses. When I come back, I'll be able to tell you everything about the Bible. Car service? Yeah. I'll be right there. Green car.
Now, wait a minute. I thought Becca put you out.
Me and Becca straight.
All right, I cleaned the flywheel and replaced the belt. Another 10,000 miles and you're going to need a new alternator.
Man, thanks.
Hey, Doug. What's this I hear about the station club?
You just finding out? Well, they're fixing the board up. The whole block. Tear it down and build some houses.
Damn. They want to do that for?
Well, I'm glad to see them do it. It's about time they did something around here. They've been talking about it for years, how they're going to fix it up and all.
White folks ain't got no sense of time. They wait till I get in position to buy me a house and then pull the rug right from up under me.
The white man ain't paying you no mind. Now you ought to stop thinking that way. They've been planning to tear these shacks down before you was born. You keep thinking everybody's against you and you ain't never gonna get nothing. I've seen 100 niggas too lazy to get out of bed in the morning talking about the white man is against them. And that's just an excuse. You want to make something of your life, then the opportunity is there. You just have to shake off that white folks is against me attitude. Hell, they don't even know you're alive.
They knew I was alive when they drafted me and sent me over to Vietnam to be shot at. They knew I was alive here.
You ain't the only one they sent. They sent a whole bunch of other folks too. Some of them wasn't lucky enough to make it back alive. You ain't the only one been in the army. I was in the army in the 50s, looking to make something out of myself. And that was after the war. I didn't know that they was going to pull out a map, stick a pin in it, and say, let's go kill some people over here. I wasn't in the army but 4 months, and they had me in Korea. 2nd Division, Company B, 4th Battalion. It was a detail company. I think at the time, the only dead body I'd seen was my grandmother. Foster buried her. That's all I knew about dead bodies. But I was meant to find out quick. The third day they put us out on some trucks and drove us into the front lines. I was scared as I could get. The last words I remember my mama saying to me was how she was praying that they didn't send me on the front lines. And I was in Korea for 3 days and here I was out on the front lines. I got out there, everything was quiet. The sergeant said, get on down off the trucks. And we got on down and started walking. We got near 200 yards when we saw our first body. Then another one. Then three more. The sergeant said, all right, boys, we're going to clean up. I want you to stack them bodies. Six high. I never will forget that. Six high. Stack them six high. Not five. Not seven. Six high. And that's what we did for the next 9 months. Clean up the battlefield. It took me 6 months before I could get to where I could keep my supper down. And after that, well, it didn't bother me no more. Never did learn to do nothing else. They were supposed to teach me, but they never did. They just never paid me no mind. There's a whole bunch of us, they never paid no mind. What I'm trying to tell you is the white man, he ain't got no special war against you. Because you buying a house and they're going to tear this place down? You're too young to be dependent on driving Jitneys. Is that what you want to do for the rest of your life?
Where else am I going to make $50 a day tax-free? Where else am I going to get that advantage?
How old are you? 24? Why don't you go to school under the GI Bill? Become something, make something out of your life. I mean, you can be anything you want. Be a pilot or an engineer or something. Like I tell my boys, the world's open up to you. When I was your age, the only thing you could get a job doing was busting dishes, running elevators, and cleaning out toilets, things like that. Now, they ain't like that now. You can be anything you want. You're young. You're kind of crazy, but you got some sense. You don't waste your money. You got sense enough to buy a house. Go to school, young blood. You're too young to be counting on driving Jitneys.
I'm worried about right now. How am I going to get me some furniture and pay that $300 a month mortgage?
Why don't you try to get on with another station?
They're all filled up. If Ace hadn't died, I wouldn't have been able to get on here.
Now talk to Becca. See if he can get you on out at the mill. He got some pull down there.
I don't want to work in no mill. I done seen what those mills did to people. And I swore I'd never work in no mill. The mill sucked all the life up out of it. That's not for me. I don't want that. I'll do anything, but I don't want that.
It ain't all the time what you want. Sometimes it's what you need. Black folks always get them too confused. Car service. No, he ain't here right now. I'll tell you. Somebody named Glucker from J&L Steel wants Becker to call him back.
Hey, Doug, what you gonna do when the station closes?
Get out of there. Now, Becker talking about quitting. I want to get together and see if we can find a place to move the station. And if that don't work, well, I guess I'll just run the bus lines until something else comes up. I ain't too worried. I got my railroad pension. I ain't got nobody but myself, so I'll be all right.
Hey, Doug, young blood, we ain't got but 2 more weeks, huh?
Yeah, that's right. You bought the place up first of the month.
What you gonna do?
I don't know, Phil.
Well, it's a shame. That's all I got to say about it. You see Becker's boy yesterday?
No, I ain't seen him. Did he come by here?
Oh, yeah, he come by. Me and Turnbull was here. Good looking boy. He come by to see his daddy. Big, strong boy. Young blood, you and Turnbull get straight now?
We okay. As long as you stay out of my business.
You ain't gonna be okay for long. Turnbull just like that. He getting everybody's business. You what? Can't pay him no mind. You got to ignore what he say.
Well, what? You and Turnbull had some words?
Turnbull put a gun on him.
He did what?
Put a gun on him.
That nigga's crazy. Now, he's gonna kill somebody one of these days with that damn gun. Either that or somebody gonna kill him. That makes the fourth or fifth time he done pulled that gun on somebody. One time he pulled a gun out on a man for 50 cents. The man took a trip and told him he'd pay him later. Turnbull seen him sitting next door eating breakfast. And he went in there and kicked the door open, waving that gun around, talking about killing somebody over 50 cents. The man ain't had a penny. He didn't talk the waitress into letting her owe him. Letting him owe her. Two, and Turnbull want to go in there and shoot the man. Somebody had to give him 50 cents to keep him from getting killed. Mm-hmm. Mark my words, one of these days he's going to kill somebody, or somebody going to kill him.
You all want me to go back up so y'all can finish?
I don't care what you do.
I mean, y'all got quiet like y'all was talking about me.
No, we wasn't.
Yeah, we was talking about you. We was talking about how one of these days you gonna pull that gun on the wrong person.
Oh, you ain't got nothing to do with that, Dub. I ain't gonna let nobody take advantage of me, that's all. That boy ain't got but one more time.
You right. You right. I ain't got nothing to do with it. Let me shut up. Young Blood, if you see Becker, don't forget to tell him that Blood can call from the meal.
Somebody called Becker from the meal?
Must be about Sheely's nephew. That boy broke into Taylor's with old man Pitt's son. Baker's trying to get him a job at the mill.
Oh, well, he can do that. He got a lot of pull down there. He done got a whole lot of people jobs. What you gonna do, Turnbull, when the station closed down?
Oh, I'm set. I'll talk to Llewellyn down on center. I'm going to take Jeff Bono's place. Bono's in the hospital with cancer.
No kidding? That's a shame.
What you gonna do?
I don't know. Dub said something about finding another place. I'm gonna wait and see what Becker said.
What about you, young blood?
I ain't got nothing to say to you.
Hey, if that's the way you want it.
You just stay clear of me, old man. Because next time, you're going to get hurt for real.
I ain't going to let nobody do nothing to me.
Don't you all start now. Come on and be friends.
I ain't starting nothing. I tried to talk to the man. Wouldn't have let bygones be bygones. He wanted threat.
I done said all what I had to say to you.
Well, all right, then. If that's the way you want it. Good. Car service. Fielder. Hello?
Oh, hey. Miss Mayberry? Sure. I'll take you shopping. Are you ready now? I'll be right there.
Did you get any calls this morning?
Not another.
God said she was going to call me at 10 o'clock. I knew she was lying when she said it. Becca been here yet?
I ain't seen him. I hear Becker's upset about you using the phone to take numbers.
Man, Becker's always upset about something.
Ring. Car service. Sheely.
Fellas, my old man been around.
Oh, I ain't seen him all day. I just got here, though. Yeah, Blood. Becker been by here, though?
I ain't seen him.
Yep, 347.
He should be back in a minute.
617 bucks 50 cents. 929 for a dollar. Yep, okay.
Hey, you take numbers.
Oh, Sheely, this is Becker's son. That's Sheely. He the number man.
Let me get $3 on 319 straight. Y'all see my old man? Tell him I've been about to see him. Mm-hmm.
Sheely. I'm going next door to clean up. If Becker comes, tell him I got a message for him.
I ain't gonna be hanging around here all day. I'm gonna get that guy 5 more minutes.
Go ahead, I'll tell him.
That's all right. I'll be right back. Oh,
yeah. That boy ain't got no good sense.
You know how to go at it.
You damn fool. Car service.
Sheely.
Sheely.
Hey, man. So, that's what I told you. Where you at? Don't move. Stay right there. I'll be there in 5 minutes. Come on, Turnbull. Give me a ride to the Ellis Hotel. This might be the one. If I don't see Rosie's face, I'll give you $5 for the trip.
Leading the parade.
I'm here. That should be enough. If I didn't want to be here, I'd be somewhere else. Why can't you just take that?
Because it ain't enough. I don't want somebody that think that just because they there, that's enough. They ain't got to do nothing else. I want somebody who's going to share with me, not hide things from me.
You want to know what I was hiding from you? I'll tell you. I've been hustling, working day and night, while you accuse me of running the streets. And all I'm trying to do is save enough money so I can buy a house, so you and Jesse can have some place decent to live. I asked Peaches if she would go with me to look at houses, because I wanted to surprise you. I wanted to pull the truck up to the house and say, bang! Come on, baby, we moving! And drive all the way out to Penn Hills and pull that truck up to the house and say, this is yours. This is your house, baby. That's what she was trying to hide from me. That's why Turnbull seen her riding in my car all the time. I found a house and I come up $150 short from closing the deal. And went to the house and took $80 out of the drawer.
A house? A house, Darnell? You bought a house without me.
I wanted to surprise you.
You gonna surprise me with a house? Don't do that! How many? Okay, a TV maybe, a stereo, a couch, a refrigerator, okay, but you don't surprise me with a house I didn't have a chance to pick out myself. That's what you was doing. That's the debt you had to pay.
You always said you don't want to live your whole life in a project.
Darnell, you ain't bought no house without me. How many times in your life do you get to pick out your house?
Wait till you see it. It's real nice. It's all on one floor, got a basement, and got a door, like a little den. We can put a TV down there. I told my Serena's gonna like this. Wait till she see I bought her a house.
No, you bought Darnell a den, that's what you did. So you can sit down there and watch a little football games. But what about the kitchen? The bedroom? The bathroom? Like, and that's one place for Jesse to play.
In this room.
How much closet space does it have? You don't just surprise me with the house and think that I'm supposed to say, oh, Darnell, that's so nice. At one point, I would have, but I ain't 17 no more. I got responsibilities. I need to know if it has a hookup for a washer and dryer.
Yeah.
Because I got to wash Jess's clothes. I need to know if it has a yard. Do it have a fence? And how far Jesse got to go to school? I ain't thinking about where to put the TV. That's not what's important to me. And you're supposed to know, Darnell. You're supposed to know what's important to me like I'm supposed to know what's important to you. I'm not asking you to do this by yourself. I'm here with you. We're in this together. See, house or no house, we still ain't got money for food. But if you had come to me and told me, if you had shared that with me, we could have went to my mother and got the money the $80 for the house and still had money for food. You just did it wrong. Darnell, I mean, you did the right thing, but you did it wrong.
No matter what I do, it's gonna come out wrong with you. That's why you jump to conclusions. That's why you accuse me of running around with peaches. You can't look and see that I quit going to parties all the time, that I quit running with Babe Ruth and Earl, that I quit chasing women. You just look at me and see the old Darnell. And if you can't look and see the way that I've changed, then I might as well surrender now. Go out here, work like a dog and try to do something nice for you. And no matter what I do, it always come out wrong because you always see the way I used to be. You don't see the new Darnell. You don't see I've changed.
I know that people can change, but I know that they can slip back to.
Oh, Rena. People believe what they want to believe, what they're set up in their minds to believe. You know what it looked like when I was gone all the time, not bringing home any money? But you could have noticed that I was tired. You could have said, Darnell ain't talking too much lately. It's because he's tired. You could have noticed that I didn't act like somebody running the streets, that I didn't come home smelling like alcohol and perfume. that I didn't dress like somebody running the streets. If you would have thought it all the way through, you could have noticed how excited I was when I got the UPS job. How I asked you if I could take it. You would have seen how I was planning things. You would see that I would get up early on Sunday, each and every Sunday, and go out to the airport to try to make a few extra dollars just before the Jitney station opened. But you ain't see all that. You ain't see the new Darnell. You still working off your memory. But the past is over and done with. I'm thinking about the future. That's why I'm trying to do something different. That's why I'm trying to buy me a house. Maybe I should have told you about the house. Maybe I did do it wrong. But I've done it. I tried to show you that I loved you. But what did I get for it?
Okay, Darnell. I could have seen all of that. But what you ain't looking at is that I changed too. We're both different people than we were. Than when we first fell in love. Darnell, I love you, but love can only go so far. When we were in high school, that was enough. That was the world, that was everything, but it ain't everything no more. I don't have the right answers, okay? Sometimes I don't even have the right questions, but I do know that it takes two people to find them. All I know is we got somebody, a little two-year-old boy, counting on us.
But I know when you place your hand in mine, you got to say, Darnell's not going to let me down. He loves me. I don't want to do anything mess this up. I don't even want to make no more mistakes in life. I don't want to get old and be talking about how I had me this little old girl one time, but I ain't seen her in 22 years.
If you don't want that, Darnell, then you gotta let me know. If we don't know what's important to one another and we don't learn to share that, then we can't make it. We can't make it with each other.
I want you, baby. I told you that. You already my pride. I want you to be my joy. Because there ain't but one thing I done done wrong. I stay away from you one night, two nights.
Where's this house at?
Pendleton. Got a nice kitchen, too. Got a nice little yard. Got a nice little bedroom. Got a real nice bedroom.
Oh, yeah? I can't wait to see it.
Where's my boy?
At my mother's house. I gotta go to my accounting class.
You wanna ride?
No. I think I need the exercise.
No,
I
no, 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 no. I'll give you a ride. I don't want to let you out of my sight. Mm-hmm. You might have to miss that little accounting class.
Why? You got something to teach me?
They kiss for a long moment. Becker enters. When he sees the couple kissing, he slams the door.
Hey,
no response.
Hey, come on, girl, I have to take that home.
Hey, Rebecca, how you doing?
I'm doing all right. How you all doing?
Well, Rebecca, I done bought me a house.
Well, where'd you buy this house at?
Penn Hills.
That's good. That's some nice houses out there. That's a smart move, young boy. Glad to see you do it. Mm-hmm. Ain't nothing like ownership property. You know, they might even ask you to do some jury duty. Now you know what? One of these days, you go out there and you're going to have fun. Now, how old is that baby?
Two. Looking like he's three, as big as he is.
Not but getting married. Hmm? Come November, it'll be 17 years. Me and Lucille been together 17 years. I told her, say, you know, work with me. She say, okay. I wasn't sure what all that meant myself, but I thought it meant pull or push together. But she showed me one can push and the other one can pull, as long as it's in the same direction.
you know? It ain't always gonna flow together all the time, you know? That's life. As long as it don't break apart. Now when you look around, you see that that's all you got is each other. There ain't much more to have. Even when it look like there is, you come one day to find out there ain't much more. Now, I ain't getting in your business or nothing, but young blood, the next time you feel that you are having some problems, you do like I do. Go sleep on the couch and live. Don't put your business in the street. Put your business in the street, be surprised how many people want to have a hand in it.
Yeah, I found that out. Even if it ain't in the street, somebody want to put it there.
See, you're learning. So you're going to know as much as I do. You and Tony bro getting along all right? You been in here?
Yeah, we all right. Some man from J&L called here for you. He wants you to call him back. Name of Glucka, I think, something like that.
Yeah. Well, if you see Dub or Turnbull or Fielding, you tell them we're going to have us a meet tonight. 7 o'clock. See what we can do about that boy.
Okay, I'll tell him. Come on, baby. I don't want to make you late for that class.
Mr. Glucka, the first man. Yeah, Jim Becker. Mr. Glucka, Becker here. When? Oh, sure. I'll be glad to do that for you. Yeah. All right, no. That's no problem. You can count on me. Say, Glucka, I got a young man that's trying to do something with his life, you know, trying to straighten himself out. I want to send him over to you. Yeah, well, that'll help. Even something temporary, you know, let him show you what kind of a worker he is. Yeah, thanks. I'll send him over to see you. His name is Robert Sheely. All right, now. Yeah, thanks again. Station's closed. Ain't no more cars here. You might going up to Webster. Corner of Roberts, Macy O'Brien got that station.
I've been thinking about what you said. So many things to think about, and after 20 years, I thought I got good at thinking. There's so many things you miss, I guess. I went out to visit Mama's grave, and I even got a...
I just saw your daddy. He must have a trip. How you doing?
Fine, I'm doing... Look, I'm just trying to figure out what to do.
If you're in the treetop, you can't do nothing but jump to the ground. But first you got to know how you got up there. Did you climb to get some apples, or was you going to buy a bacon? You got to know that because you might have to start running when you hit the ground. If you're trying to figure out what to do, you got to first figure out how you got in the situation. That's something simple. But you'd be surprised how many people can't figure that out. Is that what they gave you? They ought to be ashamed themselves. That cheap-ass wood won't cost but $1.99 a yard. They could have gave you a nice wood gabardine, a good-looking man like you. They can look at you and tell you a connoisseur of fine haberdashery. I could open up them armpits, add some shoulder pads, move them buttons, lay a double cross-top stitch on that lapel. Everybody don't know that double cross top stitch. But so many fellas can make a double cross top stitch. At one time in the old city of Pittsburgh, there wasn't but two. Me and Jimmie Green. And he couldn't make it, but so good.
I see you know something about it.
I used to make suits for Billy Eckstein. I used to make all his clothes. He wouldn't let nobody else make them. He'd be there out the road and them fellas in the band be jealous of him. They used to try and outdo each other, you know? Used to try and keep the names of their tailors secret. Count Basie found out that I was Billy Eckstein's tailor. Come through here and went lean to I made him a suit. Fucked up his whole tour. Had to cancel Cleveland and Cincinnati while he waited 10 days for that suit. Cost him $20,000 in lost revenue. But he said he didn't care. He tried to steal me away from Billy,
get Billy apart. The only thing that could do that was this here bottle. That tore a whole lot of things apart. It don't always turn out like you're thinking. It don't always have the kind of life that you dream about. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You know, I thought I was going to be the heavyweight champion of the world. Be the next Albert Einstein, but I forgot you can't live in your dreams. Now, I found that out when I was 7. I dreamt I had a bicycle. I went all over on the bicycle. I rode it around in circles. I rode it everywhere. I rode it to the store. I rode it to school. I went all over on the bicycle. Red bicycle. Had a coon skin tail hanging from the handlebars. Had a little bell on the handlebars. Now, anybody get in your way, just ring that. Had real nice reflectors. Big old seat seemed like it too big for you, but then again, it's just big enough. Had fenders in the back, a little seat back there in case you want to get somebody a ride, they just sit back there. Man, now that was one of the nicest bicycles anybody ever wanted to see. And I woke up and went looking for it. I had to go to school. Where the bike? Why don't they just hop on that? I looked all over for it. I looked in the backyard, the neighbor's yard. Where the bicycle? And that's when I decided right then and there. Dreams don't mean nothing in this world. You can be the president or a bishop or something like that. Hell, you can dream you got more money than Rockefeller. See what happened when you wake up.
You can dream love and wake up cold and hand. That's what my daddy used to say. I ain't supposed to do this, but
sure.
I can't let Becca catch me. That's against Becca's rules. I guess you know something about that.
Something about what?
I said you must know something about Becca's rules.
Yeah, I guess I do. Becca's rules is what got me in the penitentiary.
I ain't gonna carry it that far.
Get yourself a little nip.
Jitney Station. It is early morning. Turnbull, Fielding, Youngblood, and Dub sit in a circle listening to Becker. The lighting and the postures of the men convey the idea of a clandestine meeting.
All right. Y'all know what's happening. The city's fixing to board up this place coming first of the month. They're going to tear it down. They're going to tear the whole block down.
They're going to tear the whole neighborhood down. They're supposed to build some houses, and that's what they need.
They're supposed to build a new hospital down there on Logan Street. They've been talking about that for the longest while. They're supposed to build another part to the Irene Kaufman Settlement House to replace the part they torn down. They're supposed to build some houses down on Dinwiddie.
Turnbull's right. They're supposed to build some houses, but you ain't gonna see that. You ain't gonna see nothing but the tear down. That's all I ever see.
That's all there is to see.
They built that Citizen Seniors high rise on Bedford.
We ain't talking about no one building. We're talking about the whole neighborhood.
All right, sis. They boarding up the place, we gotta figure out what we gonna do.
Right.
Now, I done talked to Tanner here about renting that place down on Center, what used to be a Siegel's Ink store.
Yeah,
well, we can do that, but, or we can try and get on with another station. Well, we can go on and keep on playing by their rules like we have been, but when I first come along, I tried to do everything right. I figured that was the best thing to do, you know? Mm-hmm. Even
when it didn't look like they was playing fair, I thought to myself that, you know, they'd come around. You know, time it looked like you got a little something going for yourself, you know. They changed the rules and you gotta go and do something else. I told myself, that's all right. My boy's coming. He gonna straighten this out. I put it on somebody else. I took it off me and put it on somebody else. I told myself as long as I could do that, then I could just keep on going along and making excuses for everybody. But I'm through with making excuses for anybody, including myself. I ain't gonna pass it on no more. So I say, we stay here.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
We already here.
Yeah.
People know we here.
Yeah.
We've been here for 18 years.
Right.
I don't see no reason to lose. See here, no sir. No, I look around, all I see is these boarded up buildings. Some of them have boarded up more than 10 years. If they want to build some houses, then that's when they're going to have to tear it down, when they're ready to build the houses.
Mm-hmm.
They board this place up the first of the month, let it sit boarded up for 10, 15, 20 years.
That's just how they put Memphis Lee out of business.
Yeah, and if we don't do something, they'll put Clifford out of business.
Right.
They put
right.
Hester out of business.
Right.
Put us out of business.
Right. Right.
Now let Clifford go on and sell us these sandwiches till they get ready to build something. Let Hester go on and sell her milk and butter, because we gonna run Jitneys out of here till the day before the bulldozers come.
Right. Right.
They ain't gonna be boiled up around here, all
right?
We gotta fight them on that.
That was good to me. Come think of it, what they gonna do about it? Mm-hmm. If we say no, we ain't moving.
Right.
What they gonna do about it?
If everybody stick together, they can't do nothing.
That's right. We're gonna have to raise the dudes $10 a month.
Why?
To help pay our legal fees. We're gonna get us a lawyer. We go in there with Clifford and Hester and get us a lawyer. Do it legal. There's ways to fight. If we're gonna be running Jitney's out of here, we're gonna do it right. Get us a lawyer so he can go on down to the courthouse and file a petition. Now, there's a couple of things that come up that we need to take care of. I want all the cars inspected. The people got a right, if you haul them around in your car, to expect the brakes to work. So clean out your truck, clean out the interior of your car. Keep your car clean. People want to ride in a clean car. We provide a service to the community. We ain't just giving rides to people. We provide a service. That's why you answer the phone car service. You don't say Becker's Cabs or Joe's Jitneys. Part of that service is providing people with a way to get their groceries home, or to get their suitcases down to the bus station or to the airport so they can go visit their mama or whoever they want to visit. Well, time getting away. I gotta go down and work at JNL. They caught shorthanded and need somebody who know how to operate the machines. So I'll be over there every night this week. But remember, come next week, come Tuesday, ain't no plywood going up around here.
Yeah.
Ain't gonna be no boarding up this station, all right?
All right.
Now, young blood, now you go on over there to Hester and get us a light bulb for that lamp.
Hey, Becca, what lawyer we gonna get?
Oh, I don't know, girl. I ain't thought too much about it.
We ought to get Wendell Freeman. He the one that won that suit against the NAACP, and they wouldn't let no colored in them houses out there in Shadyside. Much money as he make on that, he ought to work for free.
How you figure he ought to work for free? Who you know work for free? Go ahead, name anybody.
I wasn't talking
who
to you.
Who you know work for free?
I wasn't talking to you.
Whoever it is, he ought to be on our side. You know, half the time, they be worried about what the city gonna say and think about them. I seen that happen.
Yeah, I have too. You can bet whoever we get gonna be on our side. They ain't gonna be going through all this for nothing. Let me get on down to the mill before the shift starts. Hey, Doug. Never mind. I'll see you all tomorrow.
All right. All right. Hey, I'm going over to Clifford's. See what he got to say about them boarding up the place.
Hey, yeah, I'm going with you. Right. Hey, you coming, Philly?
Nope.
Come on, I'll buy you a fish sandwich.
Oh, yeah. Fish with like that. Good lemonade. Don't kill nobody.
All excellent.
Act 2, Scene 3. Lights come up on Jitney Station the following day. Dub and Turnbo sit in a chair. Fielding leans against the wall by the phone. Everyone is silent and in a solemn mood. The silence swells. Fielding breaks the silence.
Becky was all right by me. We had our run-ins, but he was all right by me.
Great.
Yeah? All right. Be right there. I got a trip.
Who's the
trip? You know?
It ain't been said yet.
I wonder if he had any insurance.
What you care whether the man had any insurance?
I was just wondering. I'm allowed to wonder. I got something in my mind. I just said ain't nothing wrong.
Turbo, shut up.
Ain't no sense in me standing here trying to talk to a damn fool.
Ain't no cars here today.
Hey, Doug.
Hey.
Where is everybody?
Well, Philly went on a trip.
Seen Turbo out there sitting in his car.
Yeah, he was in here running off at the mouth.
Couldn't find a nicer man than Pepper. You know, always looking out for people, keeping things straight. Always worried about somebody else, you know? Always yeah. Looking out for them.
Yeah.
Hey, John.
Hey,
you heard?
Yeah, heard on the news last night. Man, work all them years down there, and ain't nothing happened. Retire and go back to work one day, and that's the boat, the day the boat decides to break? I can't understand it. It don't make no sense to me. I went to see Lucille and take her some money. She hit for a quarter a couple days ago.
How's she taking it?
She's taking it pretty good, considering how it happened, sudden and all that.
I have to get by and see her.
Hey,
what's going on, fellas?
Hey.
Hey, heard about what happened to Mr. Becker. Heard he got killed in an accident down by the mill. He was a good man.
Yeah, thanks.
Hey, you want any pallbearers?
Yeah, man. As soon as the arrangements are made, I'll let you know. Don't nobody know too much now.
All right, well, when you do, let me know. I'll take off work.
Thanks, Rubel. Thanks for coming around.
Here go $10 for flowers.
Alright.
Here's mine. You know that boy hit for $3 yesterday.
Who?
Becker's boy hit on that 319.
Anybody seen him?
Lucille says she ain't heard from him.
I wonder do he know.
Hey, Sheila. Loan me $2, young blood.
We taking $10 here for flowers, Philip.
What $4 I owe you?
Man, you didn't borrow $4 off that man the other day. See, Doug, that's why I wouldn't loan you anything.
I don't know nothing about no $4.
That's all right, goddammit, I know. You can just give me six back. Give me Tim about $10 total.
$10 what?
You taking up collection for the flowers?
How the hell you figure I owe you $6?
Hey, Smith.
All right, the young blood you here?
Nigga, then why don't you mind your business for once in a...
Hey, Doug, how you say I owe you $6?
I want to make sure everybody pays.
Let me take care of that.
You ain't got to know my business.
I ain't worried about your business. I'm just saying.
Hey, fellas. My old man been around here?
I just
wait right here for him, then. Y'all all sitting around. What's the matter, man? Why y'all looking at me like that for?
Ain't you hurt?
Hurt what?
What? Don't you know your dad is dead?
What? What you talking about, man? What are you talking about? What you talking about my daddy's dead? What you talking about,
he
man?
He got killed down by the...
No! What you talking about, nigga? Let me go, man. This nigga telling me my daddy's dead.
Act 2, Scene 4. The lights come up on Jitney Station. It is 3 days later. Everything is erased on the chalkboard but Becker. Youngblood and Turnbull are sitting on the sofa playing checkers. Fielding pays Dub back his money. Dub, Fielding, and Shelly sit around the station. All have just come back from the funeral.
When you moving, Youngblood?
Saturday.
You hear you bought a house in Penn Hills?
Yeah.
They got some nice houses out there. Some of them boys play for the Steelers got houses out there.
They ain't nice as them houses in Moravia, though.
Most people don't even buy houses in Pier Hills no more. You go out to Monrovia.
Let me see now. Where you say your house was again? What kind of did you buy? I forget.
Reverend Flowers, preacher, pretty.
Sure did. Maybe he would have joined the church. Have someone to preach over me like that.
Only thing you can say about you is you was an alcoholic.
I ain't studying you. Sure I drink. Everybody drink. You have to go around calling people names.
And why don't y'all hold up on that bickering back and forth? Don't nobody want to hear that today.
You all still gonna stay here? You gonna fight till my board number place to up?
What you worried for? Only thing you want is to have a place to play your numbers. That's all you worried about.
I was talking to this man right here.
I don't know, Sheila. It just wouldn't be the same without Pepper.
Nah, sure it wouldn't.
I'm ready if everybody else is. If not, I'll find a job somewhere. Go to school, raise my family, do whatever I have to, you know?
Becker was all right by me. We had our run-ins, but he was all right by me.
I just want to stop by and thank you for all the things you've done.
Sure. There ain't a man here that wouldn't have done anything for Becker.
That's right. You'd be proud of your dad. He was all right by me. I know he didn't have anything in the world. Ain't that right, Doug?
Yeah, I never knew him too much. I never knew him like y'all did. I can't say nothing wrong about him. I mean, he took care of me when I was young. He ain't run the streets and fuss and fight with my mama. The only thing I knew him to do was to work hard. Didn't matter to me too much at the time because I couldn't see it like I see it now. Nah, he had his ways, but everybody does. The only thing I feel sorry about is he just didn't get out of life what he put in. He deserves better than what life gave him. And I just can't help thinking that, but you're right. I'm proud of my old man. I'm proud of him. I'm proud to be Becker's boy. I ain't coming to preach no sermon. Ring. 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 Car service.
Lights out.